to leaders. We don't shy away from difficult conversations.
ANC Leadership Series.
We don't just tell stories. We tell you why they matter. We sift through the noise and arm you with facts.
We report about disruption and how the latest technology and innovation have changed the way we live.
We told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
It's the Philippines.
And we are ANC.
We really focus on the customer satisfaction. And we try to spend the money in our customer's best interest. You know, in every nation, there's a great tradition of storytelling, and if you can capture it on film, then we can really share it with the world.
No school, no problem.
Some parents are now considering switching to the alternative way of education, homeschooling.
Education is the single biggest barrier to economic and social mobility.
How exactly are you providing transformational education to children?
So what we decided to do was to leverage the world's best video-based technologies as well as analytical tools to try and make it possible to deliver to almost every child in the country.
What's the first thing we need to do? So I think it's very good first to prepare ourselves for this, not to dive and delve and get ourselves into it without preparing ourselves as parents and parent teachers.
Does homeschool entail that the parent teach every subject there is?
The parent is more of a facilitator of learning rather than the teacher. They don't have to know everything and teach everything because of technology.
Education has its way of finding a way back.
I wouldn't say that it is better, but clearly I'm in this space because I think that there are a lot of big gains.
The views and opinions expressed in the following program do not necessarily reflect the policies and position of this network.
Good morning, I'm Christian Esguera, and this is Matters of Fact. Here are today's headlines. The Philippines may begin vaccinations against COVID-19 as soon as next month. The Human Rights Commission calls out the Duterte administration's lack of transparency as the Justice Department submits its initial report on its drug war review to President Rodrigo Duterte. Metro Manila police obtained photos of more people who were with Christine Dacera before the flight attendant mysteriously died. And House Democrats introduce him. The Philippines may roll out COVID-19 vaccines as soon as next month. That's according to an official who faced Monday's Senate hearing on the national government's immunization program. Ina Reformina reports.
One line suggestion to Based on the COVID-19 vaccination program presented by the National Task Force on COVID-19 and the DOH at the Senate, 148 million doses of COVID-19 vaccines from seven manufacturers will be available to 50 million to 70 million Filipinos this year. But because procurement has been delayed compared to our Asian neighbors, several senators said much has to be done to restore public confidence in government's immunization plan.
Kung makinig kami sa briefing materials, wala tayong problema, para tayo nasa langit eh. But it's in the implementation, no? Yung reaction, yung responses to emergencies, wala bang sense of urgency?
Vaccine Czar Secretary Carlito Galvez Jr. explains 80% of COVID-19 vaccines are already locked into the wealthy countries which manufacture the vaccines. The rest will be divided among poorer economies, including the Philippines. The first batch of vaccines will arrive here on February 20, and the vaccinations will begin immediately.
It'll be in the third week or fourth week to vary.
Galvez says the Philippines is sure to get 25 million doses of China's Sinovac vaccine and 30 million doses of Covovax vaccine of India. These are on top of the 2.5 million doses of UK's AstraZeneca vaccine, an initiative of the private sector. Another agreement will be inked this week for 60 million more doses from a still unnamed supplier. Presidential spokesperson Harry Roque revealed areas with high COVID-19 cases will be prioritized for vaccination. These include Metro Manila, the Cordillera Administrative Region, Region 4A or Calabarzon, the Davao Region, and Cebu City. Health Secretary Francisco Duque III bears an online master list of vaccine recipients will be created to avoid duplications. Vaccination teams led by a physician will also be formed, as well as teams that will monitor and check for possible adverse reactions to the vaccine.
Uobserbahan ang mga nabakunahan sa kung sakaling magkaroon ng adverse reactions upang masuri at magamot kaagaran.
The Food and Drug Administration clarifies agreements forged by local government units with pharmaceutical firms for vaccine procurement will still go through the national government.
What are we saying here? Ibig sabihin, itong mga pinapasong agreements, itong mga LGUs na to, nangangako sila sa mga constituent nila. Hindi nila may di-deliver hanggat hindi kayo pumayag.
Unang-una po, it's a safety concern po kasi. Ang emergency use authorization po, the FDA allows the use of a product that is still under development. So hindi po approved product itong gagamitin natin. It's a product that we're using under emergency use. Kaya po hindi pa nila maaaring ibenta.
Controversy surrounding the unauthorized vaccination of the Presidential Security Group was briefly tackled during the hearing. Senator Risa Ontiveros said those who were inoculated should be monitored. FDA Chief Eric Domingo said the Health Department is already trying to get the names of those vaccinated.
Madam Chair, I have limited knowledge on this. However, I know that I received a letter yesterday from Secretary Duque. Nakasisi po ako at sumulat po siya sa PSG asking for the list of if ever anybody was vaccinated, for the list of those people, and then possible kung meron pong adverse events. No? So ang alam ko po, hiningi ni Secretary Duque yon for DOH.
The hearing will resume Friday. Ina Reformina, ABS-CBN News.
Local government units are also working to acquire their own supply of COVID-19 vaccines. According to the League of Cities, 61 cities in the country have made a 10 billion peso commitment to secure their own vaccines. This is separate from the vaccines that the local governments are expecting to receive from the national government. British-Swedish pharmaceutical company AstraZeneca was one of the first to engage in talks with the LGUs. But this does not mean that LGUs will exclusively get its vaccines from the company as talks continue with other drug makers.
We able to talk to all these prospective pharmaceutical firms so that we would be able to get all the specifications and all the details, or particularly the efficacy of all these vaccines.
The Philippine Health Department logs more than 2,000 new COVID-19 cases, the highest single-day tally in 3 weeks. This pushes the country's total number of infections to 489,736, more than 22,000 of which are still active. Davao City recorded the most new cases with 140, followed by Quezon City and Cavite Province. Health officials also reported 11 new COVID-19-related deaths and 10 additional recovered patients. There have been fewer cases being reported during the holiday season due to the limited operations of laboratories. But testing is slowly picking up, and authorities expect numbers to increase in the coming days. Malacanang urges devotees to self-isolate and to watch out for possible COVID-19 symptoms after taking part in last weekend's Black Nazarene Feast at the Quiapo Church in Manila. 400,000 people attended that religious event, with many failing to adhere to pandemic protocols. Some officials and netizens have expressed disappointment that the mass gathering was allowed in the first place, potentially making it a super spreader event.
Tapos na po siguro ang sisi. Talaga naman pong napakadaming dumalo, at talagang bagamat pinagplanuhan po yan ni Yorme, talagang at some point nawala po ang social distancing. Obserbahan ang sarili po ninyo para sa mga paglitaw ng kahit anong mga sumusunod na sintomas ng COVID-19, gaya ng lagnat, ubo, panghihina, pagkawala ng panlasa at pang-amoy, agad na mag-isolate kung meron na kayong sintomas at makipag-ugnayan sa inyong barangay.
The Philippine House Speaker says proposed amendments to the Constitution may be put to a vote in a plebiscite next year. Now, for the chairman of the Committee on Constitutional Amendments, their work will move quickly once they open discussions on Wednesday. RG Cruz reports.
House Committee on Constitutional Amendments Chair Alfredo Garbin does not see lengthy discussions on proposals to amend the Constitution to give Congress powers to relax limits to foreign investments in the country when the panel convenes this week. Garbin notes the proposals have been exhaustively discussed in the current and even past Congresses.
Sa tingin ko naman po, kung wala nang masyadong tanong at pagpasyahanan ng members ng committee, we can approve the bill. And so we can proceed with coming up with a committee report para ito ay may adapt at may i-refer na sa plenaryo.
The panel will convene Wednesday, but House leaders will already meet Tuesday with party leaders to discuss the priorities of the House, which includes charter change. Garbin insists that they won't touch political provisions of the charter, noting there is no need to amend the Constitution to accommodate President Duterte's advocacy to exclude groups plotting to bring down government from the party-list system.
If that is the sole issue, RG, then the solution lies with the Comelec, because under Republic Act 7941, there is a grounds in which a party list can be disqualified.
The poll body spokesperson James Jimenez confirms the Commission on Elections is empowered to revoke the party list accreditation of groups depending on disqualification cases filed. A study by the ABS-CBN Investigative and Research Group shows only 6 of the incumbent 61 party list congressmen belong to the Makabayan Bloc, which has been accused of plotting to bring down government. The party list coalition points out Congress only needs to pass a law to reform the party list system.
Quite naman kami, meron kaming mga in-espouse changes on it. So hindi, I don't think naman it's an attack. It's always an improvement. Kaya nga lagi tayong pwede mag-amend ng batas in order to improve kung ano yung nakikita natin na hindi na-implement ng tama.
But the Makabayan Bloc is still wary that the political amendments will find its way into the proposal one way or another. Charter change efforts have been weighed down by accusations that the administration will remove term limits.
So mind you, make no mistake about it, yung mga protectionist provisions na gusto nilang alisin, na hindi lang talaga sa economic, no, meron ding political, even human rights and social justice.
Alam niyo po, bagamat itong initiative para amendahan ang saligang batas ay jurisdiction ng Kongreso, no, hindi po nagbabago ang paninindigan ng Presidente na hinding-hindi po siya mananatili sa kanyang pwesto beyond June 30 of 2022.
Representative Mike Defensor warns the charter change bid does not bode well for the unity of lawmakers in Congress. He reiterates Congress must first address the pandemic.
Itong issue na to is a very divisive issue, and I don't think it's a proper time to discuss charter change.
hindi ito yung panahon kasi nga hindi natin maiwasan, tinamatay ng pandemya.
But for Speaker Lord Alan Velasco, the pandemic is precisely why the country needs to let more foreign investments into the country. Speaker Velasco authored Resolution of Both Houses Number 2, which amends provisions on the economy. Citing efficiency, Speaker Velasco wants to plebiscite on the amendments to the charter to be held alongside the 2022 national and local elections, giving both houses of Congress about a year to tackle and approve amendments. The poll body says preparations for the 2022 elections will continue, regardless of the plans to amend the charter. While Jimenez agrees that it is logistically a good idea to have the plebiscite with the election, the poll body doesn't really endorse any particular timetable for the plebiscite. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippines' biggest business groups calls support calls for constitutional amendments, but only regarding economic provisions. The Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry says liberalizing the charter's restrictive economic provisions will make the country more globally competitive and boost foreign direct investments. But the government must ensure the amendments are done in a deliberate and careful manner. It adds the government must also prioritize other bills that support the country's economic recovery. For public advocacy group Foundation for Economic Freedom, amending the Constitution's economic provisions will generate much needed investments and jobs to mitigate the impact of the pandemic. The group also backs House Speaker Lord Alan Velasco's resolution to insert the phrase unless otherwise provided by the law in certain economic provisions. That view runs counter to the PCCI's, which says it may weaken the country's highest law by making it easier for ordinary legislation to amend the charter. Joining us now is former House Speaker and Davao del Norte Representative Pantaleon Alvarez for his thoughts on the renewed push for charter change and his recently launched voter education advocacy, We Need a Leader 2022. Now, back in November, Alvarez left the ruling PDP-Laban party and has since criticized the Duterte administration's handling of the coronavirus pandemic. Good morning, Congressman Alvarez, and thank you for joining us on the program, sir.
Hi, Christian. Good morning.
Okay, first off, I'd like to know whether you are supportive of this latest push to amend the Constitution, but the amendments would supposedly be limited to the economic provisions. Are you in favor of this at this time?
Well, I'm really thinking of it, Christian, no? Considering the time left. Remember, October this year will be the last day for filing of the certificates of candidacy. Tapos after that, congressmen, LGUs will be very busy. They will start campaigning for the elections. Kaya medyo para sa akin, hindi maganda yung timing.
And do you think they should proceed with this, given the concern of yours regarding timing, which of course is also shared by a lot of other people, even lawmakers?
Siguro dapat pag-isipan ng leadership yan, dahil magkakaroon ng false hopes na naman na nilulunsad natin yan, tapos wala ng panahon. So wala rin mangyayari. And you know, ang pinakamabigat dyan, na issue, nagpapaiwan pa rin yung whether yung Congress, no, that includes the House of Representatives and the Senate, would be voting jointly or separately.
Okay, but how about the timing in itself? We are in the middle of a pandemic. We're not yet over the hump, most definitely. But here are certain members of Congress, led by the House Speaker, pushing for charter change. Meaning, is this something that we need at this time?
Para sa akin, sinabi ko na yon kahapon. Pag-aralan mo buti yung timing. Kasi nga, tama ka doon. Talaga nasa problema tayo ngayon, yung pandemic. Siguro, I think we really have to focus muna dyan sa issue na yan, problema na yan. Rather than going into amending the Constitution. Meron namang iba sinasabi na solusyon ito para doon sa pagbagsak ng ating ekonomiya. Sa palagay ko, pag-isipang mabuti yan, dahil para sa akin, wala akong nakikitang solusyon doon sa pag-aaminda ng Constitution.
In your case, Congressman Alvarez, what changed? Because we know that early, during the Duterte administration, you're also supportive of charter change or even the push for federalism. But now, you have changed your tune. Basically, in your case, what changed?
Well, para sa akin, Christian, nung umpisa nung administration, gusto kong isulong yung... it was not amending the Constitution. It was revising the Constitution, changing the form of government from unitary to a federal setup. So para sa akin kasi, mas maganda yon kaysa yung just amending the economic provisions at lahat. Ano? We really have to overhaul the entire Constitution for me. But it's too late to do that now. Kasi kailangan pag-usapan mabuti yan. Dumaan sa debates, no? At saka after that, kailangan yung information drive, education drive, para maintindihan ng taong bayan kung ano yung pinapalitan natin doon sa ating saligang batas. At pagkatapos niyan, meron din tayong transition period para mag-shift to a federal form of government. At this time, Christian, it's really too late.
But in this case, what do you think is the motive? You yourself said it's too late. Of course, after the amendments have been approved by both houses of Congress, assuming that they also settle the issue regarding whether to vote separately or as one chamber, assuming all those things are settled, you will still need to go through a plebiscite. And you yourself mentioned that the timing is not actually right, given the tight deadline that we have now before 2022. So what do you think is the real motive behind this latest push?
I don't really know, Christian. No? It's very difficult to speculate. But tignan na lang natin kung ano ang gagawin, at makikita naman natin, lalabas din kung anong motive dyan.
Okay. At this point, you're still part of the majority at the House, definitely. But do you still consider yourself as an ally of President Duterte at this time?
Oh, yes. I'm still supportive, you know, sa ating administrasyon. But once in a while, pag may nakita akong kailangan ayusin, ay nagsasalita ako. It's not criticizing the administration, but telling the truth para maayos yung problema.
Okay. When was the last time that you were able to speak with President Duterte?
A long time ago, siguro mga... if I'm not mistaken, before the elections of 2019.
That was over the phone, or that was personal conversation in person?
Personal, pero in passing lang. Hindi naman talaga yung...
So at this time, how would you describe your relationship with President Duterte?
Well, for me, siyempre, mahirap namang sabihin na hindi na maganda, no? Pero para sa akin, okay pa naman, wala namang problema.
Okay. Now, we know that you were putting up or resurrecting the Reforma Party of the retired General Renato Davila. How's the status now? Has it been formally resurrected?
Oh yes, we filed the necessary documents with the Comelec para ma-activate yung party. And we are now in the process also of recruiting new members, hindi muna sa mga politicians, but yung mga citizens, na ordinary citizens.
How do you see the role to be performed by Reforma as a party, as a resurrected party in 2022? Do you see this as a major platform or as a major player, at least in the presidential election?
Well, Reforma will be focusing sa presidential elections.
Okay.
Kung ano yung party principles and na gustong isulong ng partido, yun ang hahanapin namin doon sa kandidato.
Do you already have a candidate in mind?
Ay, wala pa. Kanya nga, that is the very reason why we engage ourselves into this yung voters education advocacy, yung tinatawag namin, we need a leader 2022.
Okay, alam talk, mo, Christian, talk to us about this advocacy, because of course any voter education campaign is very important, but yours is quite different because this is coming from a very close friend of President Duterte. Of course, we know what happened with your speakership, and of course I think it's safe to say that your ties with the president were somehow strained, right? So this latest push, talk to us about this. What really is driving this? Is this more of a search advocacy for a standard bearer of your party in 2022? More on that?
No. Ganito yan, Cristiano. All of us, we know that the country is facing a very big problem. These are different times. Hindi po ito kagaya ng dati na kung sino-sino na lang pwede natin ilagay bilang kanulo. Ngayon po, napakalaki at napakabigat ng problema na mamanahin ng susunod na presidente, ng susunod na pamilya. Kaya kinakailangan huwag tayong magkamali dito. Dahil dalawang panganib ito eh. Yung panganib ng COVID-19 at saka yung panganib ng pagpili ng susunod na pangulo. Yung panganib ng COVID-19, pag na ang tatamaan dyan, mga ilang tao lang. Halimbawa ako, iikot ako sa bansa, nagkasakit, maaring maging fatal. Pero ilang tao lang yan ang pwedeng mamatay dyan. Pero pag nagkamali tayo ng pili ng susunod na pangulo, buong bansa yung mamamatay. Napakahirap. So dalawang landas yung pipiliin natin. But for me, sabi ko nga, kinakailangan talaga gawin natin itong voters education advocacy para ibahagi sa mamamayang Pilipino kung gaano kabigat ang problema na hinaharap ng ating bansa at kung ano ang katangian ang hahanapin natin sa susunod na pangulo upang sa ganun sumagot nitong mga malalaking problema na ito. The next president, Christian, must hit the ground running. No time for practice. Wala na pong time para mag on the job training tayo dito. Kaya kailangan hanapin natin yun.
Basically, okay, yes. So basically you're looking for experience, right? And competence. In the latest Pulse Asia survey, we saw a number of names as preferred supposedly by that by respondents, by voters at that particular period of time. And of course, the person who topped that pre-election survey by Pulse Asia was the daughter of President Rodrigo Duterte, followed in a tie for second place by Bongbong Marcos, Grace Poe, Isko Moreno, and Manny Pacquiao. First off, what do you think of this crop of possible presidential contenders in 2022? Do you think any of them fit the requirement of your group based on the voter education advocacy that you are doing now?
Oh, Christian, I'm sorry. I don't want to comment on that, no? Kasi magiging partial na yung takbo ng advocacy. Ayokong magkomento sa yung mga surveys na lumalabas, yung mga pangalan na lumalabas. Dahil yung ating voters education advocacy, wala tayong dadalhing political personality. Wala rin tayong sisiraan na political personality. Kundi talagang ipabahagi lang sa sambayanan yung mga problema at yung katangian ng mga susunod na pangulo. So, hindi maganda na magkukomento ako. Basta para sa akin, bato-bato sa langit na lang tamaan o magaling.
But what was your initial reaction when you saw those names that came out in the Pulse Asia survey? Were you somehow happy that we have such a good crop of possible contenders? Or like many people that I was able to spoke with, many of them were alarmed. Sinasabi, ito na ba yung ano, available choices sa atin? Wala na bang iba? I mean, in your case, what was your initial reaction to that?
Well, my initial reaction was, you know, it's too early to tell. Napakaaga pa po. Kung maalala natin, in 2016 elections, ay si Pangulong Duterte nag-umpisa sa negative yung survey. Samantalang yung iba ang tataas na. But it didn't turn out that way. No? So napakaaga pa para mag-survey tayo ng mga pangalan.
Okay, but of course, you know that certain people are already being groomed for a possible run in 2022 for president. But for instance, one of those who are, whose names are being floated is that of Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte, the daughter of President Duterte. So basically, ano lang, yung, you don't need to comment on her competence, definitely. But the idea of President Duterte being succeeded by his own daughter, is this something that you think would be or should be or could be acceptable to the people?
Well, we are a democratic country. It is our right na kumandidato, no? In any position. So, constitutionally, pwede naman yan eh. Bakit hindi?
That's true. But about, of course, we always hear this this statement. It may be legal, but it may not be necessarily moral. What do you think?
Well, I'll leave it to the Filipino people to decide.
But in your case, would you prefer the idea of a political dynasty reaching as far away or as high as a presidency here in the Philippines?
If qualified, yes.
If not?
If not, siyempre, di ba? Bakit natin papayagan?
Okay. How about the dating? There are certain names that should have been considered in this pre-election survey, which are not included, which may also fit the requirements or criteria set by your group?
Well, Christian, the reason why I'm launching this advocacy is I'm hoping that I will pave the way for those people na nandyan lang sa isang tabi, no? At wala pang courage para sumali dito sa halalan ng pagkapangulo.
But what can your party offer them?
Well, the party can offer support to their candidacy. Tapos, kanya nga, the reason why we are recruiting from the grassroots, ito ay, palagay ko, hindi pa ito ginagawa ng mga partido, na karamihan kasi ng political parties ang inuuna yung mga possible na tatakbo sa iba't ibang positions. Kasi nga, kinakailangan yun para magkaroon ng organization yung isang political party. Pero ang reforma will be taking a different approach. We will be recruiting members from the grassroots who will believe in the principles of the party.
So far, how many people have you recruited?
Kukunti pa lang, Christian, kasi kaumpisa lang namin. In fact, siguro, less than 20 people pa lang.
Okay. I'm asking these questions regarding, let's say, a possible choice for a standard bearer of your party, because we know that even if the advocacy itself is honest to goodness, that you would really want to educate the people, but in terms of searching for a candidate, let's say you're able to pick one, you would still need to contend with the current political and electoral system that we have, which should have been reformed, right?
Yes.
At the time when the Federalism Initiative was launched early during the Duterte administration. My point is, you may be searching for an ideal candidate, but that candidate may not have the money, the resources, the popularity. Ergo, you would still be somehow forced to settle for candidates who are already popular, or at the very least, very, very rich, so that they would have that that good chance to win the presidential election. What do you think?
That's right. But if you have the support of the grassroots, may targeted membership yung reforma dito. Kanya lang, Christian, ito ang sasabihin ko ngayon pa lang, na reforma will stand by its principles. Isusulong talaga namin yun. At isa doon, yung essence ng federalism, yung devolution of power from the national to the local government.
How about political turncoatism and political dynasties? Would you also campaign against this? Will this also be part of your party's advocacies?
Political dynasty, mahirap kasi, Christian, no? Dahil nga, unless baguhin natin yung saligang batas, may provision doon na ensuring na wala talagang political dynasty. Kasi yung provision, ng current constitution natin, parang pampalubag-loob lang. Nakalagay nga yung provision ng political dynasties. Kanya lang, ang mali ng mga framers ng constitution at that time, sinasabi niya na it's up to Congress to legislate kung paano yung political dynasty. Eh, hindi gagawin ng Kongreso yan dahil sa dami nga ng yung political dynasty na members ng Congress. Kaya dapat sa saligang batas pa lang, nakalagay na talaga kung ano yung political dynasty.
But why would that be an easier route in terms of actually banning political dynasties? Don't you think that would even be more difficult to amend or revise a constitution to include that specific reform that we are talking about instead of certain members of a particular Congress getting together, waking up finally, going beyond their personal, economic, and family interests and actually put up or come up with an enabling law based on what is written on the Constitution? Don't you think that would be much easier? Something that you could have also pulled off when you were the Speaker of the House.
That is an ideal thinking, Christian. But in practice, it is very difficult to implement. I should be frank and honest about it. Kanya nga sabi ko, our party Reforma, ay talagang we will stand by our name, Reforma. We need reforms in our political system. If given the chance, siguro we will push still for federalism, a change in the political system of our country.
Okay. Now, the conventional wisdom is that at this time, a year before the presidential election, any sitting president is already considered as weak, if not weakened. Others say or use the term lame duck. But in the case of President Rodrigo Duterte, at least based on surveys, the ones that we have come across with, is still very popular. But do you think this particular conventional wisdom would eventually, sooner or later, at least within the year, also apply to or affect President Rodrigo Duterte? Or do you think he could flip the script and somehow still maintain his popularity and become a very, very influential force in the choice of the next president?
Well, I'm sorry, Christian, no, I don't believe in surveys. Kasi in the past, ang dami na nagkaroon ng surveys, no? Since the time of, I think, President Gloria Macapagal-Arroyo. Yung mga surveys, SWS, Pulse Asia, lumalabas na yun na nga, ang taas sa survey. Nung nakaraang elections, sa presidential elections, ganun din. Pero baliktad yung mga nangyayari. So, mahirap umasa sa survey. Imagine, ilang respondents lang yan? 2,500, 3,000, 1,000, di ba? Now, anong scientific formula para masasabi mong that is representative or that is indicative of the sentiments of the entire Filipino nation?
Of course, your concern is common among people. But if you follow also the statistics of it, basically you follow the Subbol method, wherein, if properly done, those number of respondents, of course, considering the margin of error, would be representative of the sentiment of the general population. But again, people can still, of course, debate on that. Now, I'd like to go to a final point here. President Rodrigo Duterte himself, he's very popular, assuming that the surveys are true. By the way, do you think that President Duterte, as indicated by surveys, do you really think that at this time he's still very, very popular?
Well, I think yes. He's still popular. No? Pero yung sabihin mong very, very, mahirap siguro mag-speculate doon, Christian.
The 9 out of 10 or 8 out of 10 Filipinos supporting him, you don't believe that?
Maybe conservatively, no? Tingin ko mga 6-7.
Okay. So finally, do you think this popularity of President Duterte could indeed be transferred to the candidate that he would eventually anoint in 2022?
Well, we have seen in the past, no, that popularity is not transferable. So, siguro, pagka yung preferred choice ng ng mga tao, tapos yun din yung i-endorso ng ating Pangulo, ay malaking weight. Pero pagka hindi mag-match, medyo mabigat ang labanan doon.
Okay. And Congressman Alvarez, before I let you go, how true that your party is also considering a very wealthy businessman to be your standard bearer in 2022?
Ay, no. No. That's not true.
Okay.
Well, kung sino man siya. Kung sino man siya talagang hindi.
Well, we've been hearing his name lately and it's very, it's all over social media. That's why certain pundits and even political operators have been talking about a possible presidential run in 2022. And personally, I myself have heard that your party might be considering that person to be your candidate in 2022. So you said
it's true. Alam mo, Christian, let me be frank and honest about this. Para sa akin, pagka malaking negosyante ka na, siguro tama na. Mahirap pag naglagay tayo ng Pangulo na malaking business interest sa ating bansa. Eh baka mamaya yung buong Pilipinas, eh negosyo na niya. That's very dangerous, Christian. I do not personally subscribe doon sa idea na yan.
Okay, Congressman Pantaleon Alvarez, thank you very much for joining us on the program this morning, sir.
Yeah, thank you also.
Up next, the Human Rights Commission calls out the Philippine government as it reviews its bloody war on drugs. Matters of Fact will be right back. Stay with us.
Showtime, game na! Kahit mahangin o kahit anong galaw mo, bangong panalo sa Sunsilk with 5-flower perfume for 5 times smoother and fragrant hair. Panalo! Nakakagigil! Sunsilk!
Here at Matters of Fact, we still have, here are the headlines. The Philippines may begin vaccinations against COVID-19 as soon as next month. The Human Rights Commission calls out the Duterte administration's lack of transparency as the Justice Department submits its initial report on its drug war review to President Rodrigo Duterte. Metro Manila Police obtained photos of more people who were with Christine Dacera before the flight attendant mysteriously died. And House Democrats introduced an article of impeachment against U.S. President Donald Trump for inciting last week's deadly siege of the U.S. Capitol. The Philippine Justice Department says it has completed its initial report on its review into the deaths of thousands of drug suspects under President Rodrigo Duterte's war on drugs. Justice Secretary Minardo Guevara said the report was completed last December 29th and has been submitted to the President. A copy of the report or a summary has not been released to the public yet. The Commission on Human Rights welcomed this development, but it calls out the government for its lack of transparency. CHR Commissioner Karen Gomez-Dumpit said the government had promised to cooperate with the CHR as an independent body in the drug war investigation. She now calls on the government to publicize its findings to ensure the credibility of the report. The Justice Department said it intends to involve the CHR in the review eventually. The National Bureau of Investigation says evidence so far suggests that a crime may have been committed in the death of flight attendant Christine De Sera. Meanwhile, the Philippine National Police Chief orders an investigation into possible lapses committed by the Makati Police in handling the De Sera case. The details from Dolan Castro.
The Philippine National Police now focusing on identifying those who check in at City Garden Grand Hotel's room 2207, which flight attendant Christine De Sera frequented the night before she died. NCRPO Chief Vicente Danao says they already have the pictures of around 5 to 6 people. Danao also issued a stern warning to the hotel.
We will see on the probability of violations committed by the hotel management. Okay, lalong-lalo na for not divulging immediately the names of those who book on sa room 2209 and 2207. If you refuse to cooperate, we'll file a case of obstruction of justice sa inyo for withholding information which is very vital for the early solution of the case.
The PNP hopes to gather additional testimonies from witnesses before the preliminary investigation.
Does that mean kasi na pag nag-iimbestiga tayo ngayon, we are pushing for the angle of rape? No. Ang gusto po natin ipalabas dito ay yung katotohanan if there is really a rape o wala bang rape. Sakali man na walang lalabas o walang lulutang para magbigay ng kanyang statement, so we will purely rely on the forensic science, yung results nun. Ngayon, kung sakali man na negative pa rin, alam nyo na kung saan pupunta.
On the issue of the findings of ruptured aortic aneurysm based on the first autopsy,
kung sakali man nasa puso yan, what caused the aneurysm? It could be intoxication dahil ang dami nilang nainom, no? Kasi magko-cause siya ng hypertension, iba-ibang alak eh. And worse dyan, if it is coupled with illegal drugs. Okay. Now, saan mauhulog yung possibility ng homicide? Okay. So, kung sino yung nag-induce? Kung sino man yung nag-induce, kung meron man. Pero kung wala naman, edi wala tayong maifafile na kaso. Ang problema dyan, pag siya mismo ang uminom. Also, definitely, who is to be blamed there?
The National Bureau of Investigation, meanwhile, was able to gather samples from De Sera's body when it conducted a re-autopsy.
Maaring may crime, that's what I'm saying. That's about 80% of that piece of evidence that we have. Again, this is subject to confirmatory, but I was just told medyo maganda ang development.
Maaring may crime, maaring homicide?
May crime. Let's leave it that, at that.
Meanwhile, PNP Chief Dibold Sinas has ordered a probe into the Makati Police handling of the case.
I have directed the Director for Investigation and Detective Management, or DIDM, to conduct a separate inquiry and recommend to us, not later than January 13, their findings on any liabilities of Makati police officers involved in the ongoing investigations of the De Sera case.
Sinas also denies criticisms the PNP is giving special treatment to the De Sera family.
Actually, wala namang VIP treatment. Yung dito, nag-offer kami ng space kasi nga yung mga PAL employees gusto nilang dumalaw. Before idalhin yung cadaver ni Miss Christine doon sa ano to, sa Jensen, ay wala po sila makuhang lugar. They just asked for 2 hours, no? 2 hours lang for viewing.
Meanwhile, a lawyer for one of the suspects, Louis De Lima, arrived at CADGNCR Monday to comply with the subpoena.
Not at this point, I do not want to close doors, but not at this point, Not at this time that we're 2 days away from the preliminary investigation, so let's just see.
Dolan Castro, ABS-CBN News.
And back to our story on the Philippine government's plan to roll out COVID-19 vaccines as soon as next month. We have with us this morning Dr. Tony Lechon, a former advisor to the National Task Force Handling the Pandemic. Good morning, Dr. Lechon, and thank you for joining us again on the program, sir.
Good morning, Christian. Good morning.
Okay. Of course, yesterday there was this big hearing at the Senate regarding the vaccine rollout plan of the Philippine government. I'd like to know from you, as a former advisor, as someone who had been closely, who used to closely work within that task force regarding the response of the government to the pandemic. Did you see clarity after hearing that Senate hearing? Once and for all, you saw a clear plan by the national government on how to acquire the vaccines and how to roll them out as soon as possible to the people.
I was really confused on the manner of procurement of the vaccines, considering I was considering a unified date for the vaccination, because if the vaccines will be procured separately, then you might actually lose the impact of herd immunity, meaning to say, I was expecting a one-time, big-time launch like in the States, and then all the vaccines will be launched. Let's say, since majority of the local government unit leaders have inked a deal with AstraZeneca, I was thinking that there will be one launch date for some of the national capital regions, or most of the national capital regions, so that they may attain the herd immunity at one given time, and also with the contiguous areas. Because if you have different launches, then it may not, the launches will be sporadic and may not be at one given time or close to each other, then you may lose the impact of the vaccination. So I was thinking along that line. That's why the question of Senator Lacson, do you have a day one already for the vaccination? I was looking at that because when you launch a certain product in the market, you expect a common date for all the for one product to be launched, so that it will be impactful in terms of execution.
Okay, but in this case, we don't know whether that there would indeed be a grand launch on the vaccination program. So you've expressed your concerns. But don't you trust the experts in the government now that somehow they would still identify the specific members of the population, specific sectors, specific locations on where to launch the inoculations initially to be able to achieve that herd immunity eventually?
Yeah, more or less I'm able to appreciate the hard work of Secretary Galvez and members of the IATF, but I was just expecting it would be a more homogeneous selection of the vaccines, considering because I'm worried about the variable efficacy rate to trigger an antibody response to achieve herd immunity. So I was thinking more on choosing, let's say, those with high efficacy rates and then launch them together so that you can achieve the herd immunity faster. And to me, that would be good because that will be good for the economy.
Now, there was this...
Yeah, Christian? Hello?
Dr. Lechon, can you hear me?
Yes, Christian.
Okay.
I'm here.
Now, I'd like to get your thoughts on this statement coming from Presidential Spokesman Harry Roque. He was also criticized on social media for saying this. He said that there's no option to choose because we can't really control what will come, and this is for free. So basically, people who will be or who want to be inoculated, they can choose what kind of vaccines to get coming from the government since that is free.
Well, that's a very unfair statement coming from the spokesperson, because to me, and it's written in the Constitution that health is a basic right and it's about wellness. and we deserve to be choosy because we need to find the right vaccines for us and based on efficacy and safety. And almost all the surveys are saying right now that there's vaccine hesitancy because of the safety concern of the vaccine. And when there's a safety concern, I think you need to heed the call of the customers as well as the people that you need to provide the right the efficacious and the safety vaccine. So I think it's an unfair comment and statement. I think the government works for the people, and I think the government should actually follow that particular aspect of looking for the right vaccine. And there are two non-negotiable things that the people would want, and that is basically efficacy and safety of the vaccines.
Okay. Finally, we know that a number of local government units have begun approaching private companies or manufacturers for their COVID-19 vaccines. They're doing that initiative on their own. But we know that they're signing tripartite agreements because they also need, of course, to get the consent, or they need to get the national government involved. Now, some people are suggesting that perhaps it would be better if the local government units would be allowed to engage directly with these pharmaceutical companies, with these vaccine manufacturers, without necessarily having to involve the national government, because there is this perception that the national government has been quite slow and that the LGUs work much faster. What do you think? Do you think LGUs should be left alone in terms of vaccine acquisition?
I think for the last 10 months, we see the style or the style of leadership of the IATF, and even if their response to a certain situation, it's quite slow. We're actually on the 11th month of quarantine, and I think the local government unit leaders are quite dismayed with the performance of the IATF. So they are taking the leadership right now in terms of coordinating with the pharmaceutical companies. But there's a certain limitation because according to USEC Eric Domingo, globally, it should be the emergency use authorization and only the central government should be able to do that. But I actually, in agreement with Senator Recto and Senator Delon, that we can tweak the law in order to suit the local government unit, because, you know, it will be quite faster if the local government unit will actually coordinate with the pharmaceutical companies. I'm in agreement with them that we should delegate with authority, and we should actually avoid bottleneck at the IATF level or the central government. And they should be given the latitude to prepare the community for vaccination, because the task is quite gargantuan in terms of rolling out. And I think it's about time that they delegated authority to the local government unit leaders.
Okay. Dr. Tony Lechon, thank you very much for joining us, sir.
Thank you very much, Christian.
Okay. And that will do it for the show. I'm Christian Esquera. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of ANC shows online by subscribing to the ANC YouTube channel. Connect with us on Twitter at ANC Alerts or email us at ancfeedback@ebs-cbn.com. Catch us again same time tomorrow here on Matters of Time.
Returns to the streets of Hong Kong. The UN chief also urging world leaders to take the lead in the fight against climate change.
Carmina Constantine bringing you the latest news Monday to Friday at 12 noon on Dateline Philippines.